Chairpersons, I would like to call Mr. Dr. Callum McBride. Sir, please have a seat. May I request Dr. B.N. Singh, and I would like Dr. Sushil sir to please accompany him. So we would be starting this session with tips and tricks in total hip replacement, and we would be focusing on developmental dysplasia of the hip. So may I request Dr. Ramchandra Sivad sir to please be on the dais, and may I request the press persons to kindly shut down please. Oh sorry. May I request Dr. R.C. Sivad sir to please kindly carry on with his presentation sir.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Chairman and Co-Chairman. On the outset, I must be thankful to Dr. Ashish and the whole team finding me suitable to give a talk on the master's course at Patna. I am very grateful to Dr. Ashish and his team. I have been probably knowingly allotted this topic in which you don't have series because every case has its own problems. Many times there is no similarity in the cases. I will present my work in another 10 minutes, some tips and tricks to manage the dysplasia. Total hip arthroplasty in development dysplasia of the hip presents many challenges to the operating surgeon. The complex femoral and acetabular anatomy makes the standard reconstruction technically challenging. Each patient is unique, makes situation even more difficult. And the functional outcome of total hip arthroplasty in DDA are generally good to excellent, though higher rates of mechanical failure have been reported in this group. With this background in mind, we started straight with the challenges, that what are the challenges in dysplastic hip. We have soft tissue considerations, abnormal bone anatomy, both acetabulum and femur, shortening and neurovascular issues. These are the four areas I will touch in next few minutes. The soft tissue considerations in dysplastic hip are the muscles around hip. They are all contracted. Abductor, gluteus medius, minimus, flexors, iliopsoas, rectus femoris, adductors, and a thick and elongated capsule, because the entire process is intra-articular, intracapsular. Neurovascular problem if you had to increase the length more than 3 centimeters. Bony considerations, acetabular challenges are characterized by deficiencies, especially anterolateral and superior areas. Shallow and very narrow acetabulum. Very, very careful to put a small shell and small head. Iliac bone is thickened posteriorly and superiorly in relation to the level of true acetabulum. That is a little good sign. And very soft periarticular bone that if you lean little more, everything becomes very loose. Acetabulum is more retroverted, to be underlined, that acetabulum is more retroverted with or without high hip center. Femoral changes, challenges. Femoral head is elliptical. It has increased antiversion. That is retroverted, it is more increased antiversion. Decreased intramedullary canal, very straight contours. High neck shaft angle and low femoral offset. These are all odd things are available in this. And mostly there is a mismatch between the metaphysis and diaphysis of the femur. So one piece of stem, mostly you are in difficulty. Thinner cortical diameter for the risk of fractures and missing medial calcar in flare is seen. You can see here, if you look on this x-rays, you can see here that there is almost straight bone and there is a mismatch here. Classification, we have a standard Krause and Ranawat classifications characterized especially based on the amount of femoral head displacement from acetabulum. If it is less than 50, it is type 2, 50 to 50, 75 subluxation is type 2, type 3, 75 to 95, and type 4 is normally 100% subluxation or dislocation. This scheme is basically a guideline for acetabular component reconstruction. That is the base to be made on this classification. You can see the classification, the type 1, type 2, type 3, and total dislocation type 4. This helps that where you have to put the cup and how you have to put the cup. Radiology, hip joint and pelvis involving the thigh, at least minimum 2 views AP and lateral are necessary to assessment the stage of dysplasia, preoperative planning for femoral canal mismatch and acetabular status. Sometimes we have to take few more radiographs for the acetabulum, but now 3D CT scan is very important in understanding the anatomy of the acetabulum. You can see here, you can clearly see that how much it is out, and if you take a view of the innominate bone, the acetabulum is clearly visible. Now the treatment issues, surgical technique and approach, choice of implant and femoral anatomy. These are the three things which one has to keep in mind. Surgical approach, posterior, posterolateral, direct lateral, anterolateral, all approaches have been described. But first two, posterior and posterolateral, are popular. The advantage of posterior approach and posterolateral are that it minimizes the damage to abductors, provide easier access to the diaphysis if the femoral osteotomy is needed, and facilitate the direct visualization of sciatic nerve tension if releases are to be made. I frequently use the posterolateral approach and I am happy with that. This is the planning, how you have to find out where is the trochanter, how you have to take an incision. Technique, the clinical limb length measurement, templating, since morning, yesterday, its importance has been highlighted, both in this case, because there is a mismatch between the stem, the metaphysis and diaphysis. Need of acetabular graft, neck cut, surgical approach and wake-up test is essential when you increase the length more than 3 cm. Capsulectomy is very important aspect of the exposure. 360 degree exposure, global exposure is required. Flexors, iliopsoas, rectus femoris are released. adductor tenotomies are done. Abductors are spared as much as possible, and especially in such cases of dysplasia, we take a little longer neck cut, 15 to 20 mm of the medial neck side above the trochanter to adjust the length. And if lengthening is more than 3 cm, the risk of neurovascular compromise start increasing. Principles of acetabular reconstructions. Try to restore the hip center as close as possible to the normal. But don't try that it should be absolutely normal, very close to normal. Since most of hips will have some degree of loss of superior acetabulum, and placing the acetabular component slightly more proximal will usually provide some better coverage superiorly. If the acetabular component is placed more than 15 mm above the hip center, there is a higher incidence of component loosening, and surgeons should avoid temptation to put the acetabular component in false acetabulum, because then loosening is very, very early. This is the normal, you have put it here, it looks nice, but this is a very soft bone, and very shortly it becomes loose. So this temptation should be avoided. And mostly people have a temptation why to do a femoral osteotomy. The acetabular deficiencies can be addressed in one of the several methods. And acetabular reconstruction at the anatomic hip center with augmentation using the bone graft or augment is preferred. Second, and early easy, like in type 1 and type 2, we can do only medialization of the anatomic hip joint to obtain sufficient lateral coverage, so you need not too much. Superolateral displacement of hip center decreases the abductor movement by arm of 28 degrees. You can see here, it has gone up. This is the operative procedure. You can very clearly see the head. It has been visualized. You can see here in this, and the screws have been put in, the graft has been fixed. You can see here, not working. It's not working because this is a difficult area, that's why it is not working. See, you can see the screws, you can see the screws fixed, and now well covered acetabulum. That is an important aspect, that it should be well covered. Maybe screws, sometimes you may need cages to fix it if you are slightly over enthusiastic to put a bigger head size. This is the acetabular graft, well taken up, no issue in this. You can see the another autograft.
I'm very pleased.
Acetabular reconstruction is easier in crow 1 and 2, it is wrongly 4, and 3 and 4 require modification of the standard procedures. Small diameter acetabular cup are required uniformly in management of all types of dysplasia. So you should be very careful that you should have a small type of diameter. You can see only the medialization. We have just medialized and no graft is required, fully covered. This is type 1. But you need many a time the cage because you don't have much bone here.
Dhanyavaad sir, Mr. Ji. Hamare baare mein itni achhi baat. Bahut bahut dhanyavaad.
Sharing with Dr. Kamal that if they overream, they will lose the wall. You can see the cases, how badly they were. The another one in which the wall has been broken. Principles of femoral reconstruction, crow 1 and crow 2 class allow the positioning of femoral head in optimal hip rotation center without performing any femoral shortening procedure. But 3 and 4 dysplastic hip, you should be ready. You should not struggle. You should be ready to do the femoral shortening procedures. However, surgeon must be prepared to perform a femoral osteotomy. Preoperative templating of the lateral femoral view is most important in these cases because they have a very narrow canal. You can see here the modal femoral head below the sleeve, and you can see the osteotomy has been done. And there is no issue thereafter. It is easy to bring down. So you normally need the stem which has two type, two sleeves. Sleeve up and a small prosthesis down. Single stem sometimes is difficult. I'll show you one case. This is another case where the osteotomy has been done and it has been brought down. No problems. In this case, if you see,
Bihar ki sarkar ki taraf se swagat aur
abhinandan. Put the one single stem. It was very narrow, and I splintered the bloody entire femur. Wherever it has gone, then I had to change for the restoration stem and put these cables. I was through. So you should be wise, and wise are those who learn from others' mistakes. I have committed this. So to summarize, when preparing to perform a THR in DDH, Crow classification can be used safely for anatomical deformities, especially in the acetabulum. The surgeon need to know, come to know the surgery with this degree of complexity, well prepared, especially for the smaller acetabular component and modular fluted stem for all. One must always be prepared to perform a femoral osteotomy. It is difficult to predict when it is required. You should always have mesh keys and cables along with you. So, friend, to conclude, you find a altered anatomy, careful exposure, try to near normal anatomy, neurovascular complication are devastating. Wake up test should be done if lengthening is more than 3 cm. It is a satisfying procedure, but it is not a beginner's surgery. With this, I want to give a message to my younger colleagues that in my 2 decades of the total hip and knee replacement surgery, for the first 5 years, I used to think that I know everything about the hip joint. I was full of knowledge from literature, from hearing, from this. Next 5 years, I realized that no, I don't know entire procedure of a total hip, how mechanics it works. And now in last 10 years, after doing more than 2000 hips, I realized that I don't know much about the total hip replacement as I used to think, because every patient is a unique patient. Sometimes you feel that you will come out. If you are not prepared, it is a disaster. For all plates, everything, you have solution there and there. But if it dislocate, if it is shortened, if it is antiverted, you have a sleepless night. With this remarks, thank you very much for kind listening. And thank you very much for the speakers.
Thank you, Dr. Siva, sir, for giving me the wonderful lecture over the developmental dysplasia of hip. Thank you, sir. I would like to invite Dr. B.D. Chatterjee, sir, for giving the brief presentation over the aseptic loosening of THR.